Okay. So the third specimen. These two were post-mortem specimen. This is an anti-mortem specimen. So wet mount anti-mortem specimen of total laryngectomy. The entire larynx is taken out. Wet mount anti-mortem specimen of total laryngectomy. Now if you see this larynx, what you are seeing here is something like this first. So all of you can see this structure, the most prominent structure, that is the epiglottis. Okay. Where the epiglottis ends, you can see two prominent structures. Where the epiglottis ends, there are two prominent structures, they are the arytenoids. So epiglottis, the arytenoids. This is the start of the epiglottis. It is larynx which is closed, which has been cut open like this. So we are seeing epiglottis, the arytenoids. In the center, you are seeing all irregular growth. In this part, you are seeing all irregular growth. Okay. So epiglottis, arytenoids, the entire part is larynx. The center where the growth is present is the area of the glottis. Here there are vocal cords. So this is the area of the glottis. Glottis is the area where there are vocal cords. So from the epiglottis, here you cannot see. Here you can see all growth. But there will be a false cord, there will be a true cord. So from the epiglottis till false cord, this is supraglottis. Again, we will discuss in theory also. Supraglottis, between the false or between the two true cords is the glottis. And below this is subglottis. So supraglottis. So this is the antemortem wet mount specimen of total laryngectomy showing epiglottis, supraglottis, growth in the glottic area and subglottic area. Okay. It is the irregular growth. Then you can see on the sides there is a prominence on the sides here. So this is arytenoid. On the side you can see two prominence like hand, which is just seen like this. So this is the greater corona of thyroid cartilage. So larynx has got three cartilages, paired and three unpaired. The unpaired cartilages are epiglottis and the thyroid cartilage, and below is cricoid, which is not very clearly seen here, but epiglottis, and we can see two greater corona of the thyroid cartilage. This is all that you describe in this specimen, that this is the specimen of total laryngectomy showing the growth in the glottic area. Now there are questions in this. First question, where is the growth? So growth, it's the irregular fleshy growth seen in the glottic area, that is the area of the vocal cords. Second, what could be the symptoms of the patient, or how did this patient present in the OPD? So this is a case of carcinoma glottis or carcinoma larynx. The first symptom for carcinoma glottis is always change in voice or hoarse voice, and as the symptom progress, because the area is same for voice and for breathing, if it is if large growth, patient can go into stridor. So early stage will be change in voice, and late stage patient will have stridor. Then question can be, what are the indications where we remove the entire larynx? Do we remove in all cases? No. So there are certain indications only where we remove the entire larynx. All malignancies of in the body, especially head and neck area, they are divided into stages. Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. So any stage 3 and stage 4. So late stage 3 and early stage 4 disease, generally we go for total laryngectomy. Late stage 3 and early stage 4, we go for total laryngectomy. Early stage 1 and 2 or early stage 3, they require radiation as a therapy. So radiotherapy can be done. In later stage, we remove the entire larynx. Next question can be, now larynx is important for voice, speech also. So after removal of larynx, can the patient talk? So once the larynx is removed, patient cannot talk. But there are various ways in which we can make him talk. There are three important ways. One is esophageal speech. Again, we'll discuss in lecture. Basically, it is the patient is told to swallow the air in the esophagus and he burps out, and then he is made to talk. So So esophageal speech. Second is artificial larynx, in which there is a, basically when we talk, it is the vibrated air which passes from the larynx, goes into the articulator, that is the mouth, tongue, teeth, palate, and then it forms words and comes out. Basically, vocal cord just gives vibratory sound. It is the articulators which give us the words. Okay, so there is a vibrator which can be used, which is just kept somewhere below in the submandibular area, which just vibrates, and as it vibrates, the air in the oropharynx vibrates, and then patient articulates with tongue and teeth. The throw of voice may not be good, but at least he can talk. So that is artificial larynx which can be used, artificial voice device can be used. And third, or the most commonly used method and the most effective, is tracheoesophageal fistula. Tracheoesophageal fistula based speech. What fistula is the restriction? Tracheoesophageal fistula based speech. Just we understand this concept. There is esophagus, there is larynx, which then continues as trachea. Here there are vocal cords. When we are talking, when I want to talk something, first of all I think what I have to talk. Okay, talking is an expiratory process, and we are always breathing out when we are talking. So once I know what I have to talk, the lungs, and how much I need to talk in one breath, that much I'll first breathe inside. So once we breathe inside, and when we have to talk, the expiratory air goes out, goes in the trachea. This is the vocal cords or the glottis, so it reaches the subglottic area. As it crosses the glottis, the vocal cord vibrates, and this vibratory sound or the air is then taken to the oropharynx, where there are palate, teeth, tongue, all these articulators, depending on the sinus condition, the voice or the speech comes out, the words comes out. Okay, now in this patient, total larynx is out, this part is out, this everything is present, the larynx is not there. So, and patient is breathing from a permanent tracheostoma. So how will he talk? One we discussed was, he will swallow air and he burps out the air, but the air coming out may not be very much, it's not too much. Second was, we use a vibratory device here, and the vibratory sound, the vibration of the oropharynx takes place. Third is, we make a fistula between the trachea and the esophagus. We make a fistula and we put a prosthesis between the trachea and the esophagus. This part is not there in this patient. Larynx is out. Here we have sutured it, it's closed. This is gap, and here again there is suture. Okay. He is breathing from tracheostomy. So now when there is, if we put a prosthesis device here, when the patient has to breathe, has to talk, he puts a finger on the tracheostoma and he expires. So when he expires, normally the air which comes out from tracheostomy, now because there is a finger here, it goes in the through the valve into the esophagus. Some air can go down, but majority of air then goes into the oropharynx from the esophagus. The advantage is, we get the entire lung power for speech. The esophageal swallowing may be just 5 to 10 ml of air. We can maximum speak one or two words. In this case, patient can almost use the entire tidal volume for talking. So he can talk in sentences. He again requires speech therapy, but this is the most commonly used tracheoesophageal fistula based speech. More details in lectures, but these are the three ways in which patients can talk. Then, how does the patient breathe? He has a permanent tracheostoma present, tracheostomy present, from which he breathes. So these are common questions. What is the etiology of CA larynx? Can be